see all of you here today. Glad you came to spend this time in worship with us. Isn't it beautiful outside today?
Yes.
I mean, it's so nice to finally have October here in Katy, Texas. I want to point out a couple of things to y'all. First of all, at the end of every single pew, there is a little blue book. And what I'd like to ask is that if you are a member of Holy Covenant, if you would just go ahead and sign your name in, let us know that you are here. Even if you just put an X, just something, let us know. Our intention and our idea is this, is we want to help you be accountable to being here in this time of worship with us each and every Sunday. If you are visiting with us today, there's a place in that book for you to sign in as someone who is coming to visit, whether it be your first time or your 100th time with us. It is not a requirement to sign in, but I'd like to invite you to do so. By signing in and letting us have just a way of contacting you, we're able to reach out to you and talk to you a little bit about who we are and what we are. And that way we can answer questions that might come up. You should have received a bulletin this morning. And in this bulletin is going to walk you through the worship experience. And you're also going to find in there a place that you're able to write notes. And it is my hope, it's my desire that at some point in this service, something inspirational is going to happen for you. The Spirit might speak to you, and that you can write down something that's going on through your mind, not a grocery list, okay? Put your mind on the God for this next hour, 10 minutes, and write down something there that can lead you this next week into further acts of worship. I hope that you'll take this as not an advertisement, but as me inviting you to do something with me. A lot of us, we come to worship, and our ideas is, I want to come to worship, I want to come and be in the attitude of worship, and then I want to go through the worship experience. And that's very good. That's all of us should be feeling like that. But some of us come on a Sunday morning, and we say to ourselves, I'd like to help someone else have a worship experience. If you remember a couple of weeks ago, I talked about ushers and the priestly role of the usher, how ushers are not just doorstops. They're not meant to be people who are just sitting there handing out bulletins. Instead, usher is a role that is designed so that it can help people move from the outside and become comfortable in worship. Especially those that might be non-religious or nominally religious. We can never assume when someone walks through our doors that they know everything about being Methodist and everything about going to church. It can be kind of disorienting to come into a new place and wonder what's going on. And the usher's role is an opportunity to help someone feel comfortable, to help take anxiety away, and help them enjoy worship itself. And I'd like to say this to you. If you would like to be an usher, if you'd like to help greet other people and help bring people into worship itself, we're going to be having a training next Sunday, right before we launch into our Advent or Christmas season. And I'd love to have you come be a part of it. I'll even serve you lunch. So about 12 o'clock, 12:15, we'll be having a little lunch together, and then we're going to be meeting and talking about the role of the usher and putting our usher teams together. And that'll take about 45 minutes. And then following that, at 1 o'clock, we're going to have a training for all of those that would like to help being a greeter on Sunday morning. This is a different role. It's a different helper role. They also help people feel less anxious when they're coming in. But the greeter role is to answer questions about worship as well as helping them move around our campus. A lot of times people come in and they've got babies, they've got young children, they don't know where to go with them or what to do with them. The greeter role, or out here at the Welcome Information Center, helps them find where they need to go and do what they need to do to feel less anxious. These are very important roles, and if you would like to be a part of those, you can come at noon and stay through the usher training as well as the greeter training, or you can come back for the greeter training, or just stay for the usher training. It's a mix and match. You can do anything you want to do. But just know this, you're being asked to prayerfully consider these roles and your opportunity to help others enjoy worship too. Speaking of worship, let's begin ours by standing and singing together.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you who sent your Son as an example of how to live and empowered us to be your disciples, we pray that your Spirit might guide us in how to be disciplined followers of your example, so that we might be able to grow every day more into your likeness. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today's scripture reading is Isaiah 65, 17 through 25. Would you please stand as you're able for the reading of the scripture? Look, I'm creating a new heaven and a new earth. Past events won't be remembered. They won't come to mind. Be glad and rejoice forever in what I'm creating, because I'm creating Jerusalem as a joy and her people as a source of gladness. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad about my people. No one will ever hear the sound of weeping or crying in it again. No more will babies live only a few days, or the old fail to live out their days. The one who dies at 100 will be like a young person. The one falling short of 100 will seem cursed. They will build houses and live in them. They will plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They won't build for others to live in, nor plant for others to eat. Like the days of a tree will be the days of my people. My chosen will make full use of their handiwork. They won't labor in vain, nor bear children to a world of horrors, because they will be people blessed by the Lord. They, along with their descendants, before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. Wolf and lamb will graze together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. But the snake, his food will be dust. They won't hurt or destroy at any place on my holy mountain, says the Lord. May God bless the reading, hearing, and understanding of the scriptures.
You may be seated.
Oh,
do they have a special purpose? What kind of gloves are they? They're working gloves. Okay. So what do you think they can do? They could plant plants. Look, they're not doing anything. They're just sitting here. Oh, I need to put my hand in it. I could what? Oh, okay. So when they were just by themselves, they couldn't do anything. But if I put my hand in it, they're filled up and they can do things. But is it the glove by itself that's working, or is it my hand? It's my hand, which reminds me of a scripture that Paul says. He says, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So when the glove is empty, I can't do anything. But when I put my hand in it, it can pull weeds, and it can protect my skin. Like if I was carrying some wood, it would protect it from splinters. So I could do a lot of things. So it's kind of like us. We can't do anything good without Christ in us, like the glove. So the scripture that's going to be read in just a little bit is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. And Paul is talking to the people and he's telling them, don't be idle. Do you know what idle means? What do you think it means, Mary? Don't be bad. And he doesn't want them to be bad. But idle is kind of like this loveliness, just sitting here doing nothing. When you do nothing, he said, don't be idle. We want you to work for the kingdom of God. But then he also tells them, but you Christian brothers do not get tired of doing good. So that means we have to do good things. And on Wednesday night, a lot of the people from the church came together and put together buckets for people that had been in a flood. And the buckets had things like work gloves and soap and stuff to help them clean up after the flood. And a lot of you guys helped me. We gave you a really hard job. Do you remember what it was, Nate? You want to tell me? Trash bags. We had to roll it out, and how many did you have to count out? 24. And that was really kind of hard because then we rolled them back together. They were kind of slippery and it was hard to get them stacked up. But these guys worked the whole time until every trash bag was counted and stacked up. So you didn't get tired of doing good, did you? You worked really hard. So that's what the Apostle Paul is telling us. Don't get tired of doing good. Can you pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you give us the privilege to work for you. We just pray that you would help us to never get tired of doing good. In Jesus' name, amen.
Brothers and sisters, we command you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to stay away from every brother or sister who lives an undisciplined life that is not in line with the traditions that you receive from us. You yourselves know how you need to imitate us because we were not undisciplined when we were with you. We didn't eat anyone's food without paying for it. Instead, we worked night and day with effort and hard work so that we would not impose on you. We did this to give you an example to imitate, not because we didn't have a right to insist on financial support. Even when we were with you, we were giving you this command: if anyone doesn't want to work, they shouldn't eat. We hear that some of you are living an undisciplined life. They aren't working, but they are meddling in other people's business. By the Lord Jesus Christ, we command and encourage such people to work quietly and put their own food on the table. Brothers and sisters, don't get discouraged in doing what is right. May God bless the reading, hearing, and understanding of these scriptures. You may be seated. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray that your Holy Spirit would be with us so that we may not grow tired of doing good. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So this is part two of a series that Fred kicked off this past week, where we learned about the saints. Now you learned that you yourself are both saint and sinner, the collective body of the church. We're all called saints. But saints are also those who have gone before us, the ones that have passed away in faith. And they are people who show us how to be more faithful. We proclaim that we believe in saints in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints. We pray in our communion prayer, the Great Thanksgiving. We pray with your people on earth and the whole company of heaven as we join and sing their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord. And so the saints show us how to be faithful Christians to the end. And I think they also help us understand Scripture because they live Scripture. So I wanted to take some time to tell a couple stories of the saints so that we might better understand this passage from 2 Thessalonians. Now, I don't know about you, but you may read Scripture to feel comforted. You may read Scripture because you are disciplined and you are going through a reading plan or reading the entire book of Scripture. You may read Scripture just because you want to find some kind of comfort or some answers to questions that you may have. But I bet none of you are reading Scripture so that you can be sucker punched in the gut. Paul here is being a total jerk. He commands us. If Paul came in straight through those middle doors and he commanded me to do anything, I'm going to look at Fred and say, who does this guy think he is? It takes somebody who has actually seen Jesus face to face to have the authority to command people to do anything. But Paul here is deeply concerned for a community, not that it's undisciplined in all that they do, but they're undisciplined in doing the right things. They find themselves being disciplined in getting in the way, in causing chaos in their community, messing with other people, not building them up. People are being a negative force in the community of the church when what they need to be doing is being disciplined in doing good. And so Paul really kind of calls people like Fred and I out. You know, he comes into the city of Thessalonica, and he doesn't even get paid for it. He works a second job so that he can support himself, so he can be an example. That's not fair to us, you know. I want him to get paid. I enjoy this. But rather than preaching some kind of anti-welfare speech, Paul is desiring that people would learn from his example, that he would embody his message, that he would show us how we can be disciplined in doing good. One of the saints that teaches us how to be faithful and disciplined was known as Anthony, or Antony of Egypt. Anthony was raised in a rich family, land-owning family. They were farmers in Egypt, and along the River Nile is that fertile place. And one day he was walking along and he saw a preacher, and the preacher was telling the story of the rich man that came to Jesus. And Jesus said, if you want to be perfect, go sell all your possessions, give them to the poor, and follow me. And so Anthony walked away, sad because he was very rich, and that's the story of Anthony of Egypt. No, he actually responded to the message. He responded to the message of go sell all your possessions. So he did just that. And he moved to the outskirts of town, joined a community of people, and started to pray and fast and read scripture. And so his days became just that, fasting and praying and reading scripture. And he began to move farther and farther and farther outside of town, to the point where he was living in the middle of the desert, praying, fasting, reading scripture. This became his daily rhythm. The only people who he had for company were other monks who were doing the same thing. Reading scripture, praying, fasting. And his story could have easily ended there. He could have lived out his days in that community of people who were praying, fasting, reading scripture. But one day, he came out of the desert. And he moved to Alexandria, the center of learning and culture and commerce in Egypt. This is like a guy from the panhandle of Texas moving to New York City. And there he met a young man named Athanasius. Athanasius would go on to become one of the earliest fathers of Christian theology. We know how to talk about the Trinity, for example, because of people like Athanasius. And so while Anthony worked making mats and gardened, he was able to show Athanasius how to be faithful. He was able to mentor. And Abba Anthony, Daddy Anthony, as people called him, became the father of all monks. He was one of the first monks in the Christian tradition. And so he surely inspired this next saint, Martin. Martin was from France, but in the Roman period, and he was part of a Roman military family. And because he was a part of that family, he was expected to go into the military. He was drafted, really. And so at the young age of 16, in his military regalia, on a cold day, he comes upon a man who's poor and naked and just lying in the streets. But he sees the man's humanity, and he kneels down, takes off his cloak, pulls out his sword, and cuts it in two. And he wrapped that man in the other half of his cloak. Writing about his life later, a lot of people noticed that this is like him responding to the words, "If you are naked, if you are naked, you clothe me." And so surely St. Martin was the person who, when he came to Jesus, said, "But when did I clothe you, Lord? When were you naked?" And Jesus will say, "Just as you have done to the least of my brothers, you have done to me." This was Martin's moment. His heart turned and he desired to be not a soldier for the Roman military, but in his words, a soldier Christ. Not that he would kill for the cause of Christ, but he would take the discipline that he learned from being in the military and apply it to his life as a Christian. And so just like the man before him, Abba Anthony, he moved further out into the country and began a strict regimen of prayer, fasting, reading scripture. And he too would have lived out his life just reading scripture and praying and fasting when some of his followers got a great idea that they would kidnap him and force him to be a bishop. His one last act of rebellion was, instead of sitting in the big throne that he was supposed to sit in as a bishop, he desired to sit in a small three-legged stool. Through these years of prayer, fasting and reading of scripture, he learned to be a humble leader above all else. Now, I wouldn't put myself in the same category of a saint by any means, but I did learn something about discipline during my time as a football player. Now, I never talk about the fact that I was in football, so don't ask what position I was, I was terrible, that's all you need to know. But I learned what it means to be disciplined because of the team. I was never particularly disciplined before being on a football team, but somewhere together as a team, we are able to build each other up to help ourselves be more disciplined together. Paul, writing to the church in Thessalonica, was not asking them to each go their own way and be individually disciplined. Instead, he was calling the whole community to work together to be disciplined in doing good. And in the same way, although people bring up individual people like Abba Anthony, the reality is he was not alone. He had dozens and dozens of people surrounding him. They worked together to be disciplined in doing good. And so that teamwork of discipline helped him become the mentor that he was in a later life. And then Martin, as a military man, knew firsthand that it takes a group of people working together to be disciplined. We have to keep each other accountable. So Holy Covenant, we too are a team working together. We need each other in order to be disciplined in doing that which is good. And we, Holy Covenant, are called to something in particular. God is desiring that we are a Christian presence here in Katy. We have the opportunity to care for the children and the families and individuals right here in Katy. All of God's people here in Katy. It's a beautiful calling to which we've been called. But we can't do it alone. It's going to take discipline to do it. Now, this past week, we had a national election in the United States. And you're all worried what I'm about to say. But the changing of a political atmosphere does not change what our calling as Holy Covenant is. Although the dynamics of the community might change a little bit, although things might change nationally a little bit, that doesn't change the fact that God has called us, Holy Covenant, to be God's people here in Katy, Texas, right now. God calls us to care for the children, families, individuals here. And so we can learn from Paul, who called us to be disciplined in doing good together as a community. We can learn from Abba Anthony about how to mentor and care for the children. And we can learn from Martin about how to be humble leaders. So my prayer for you today is that you may go knowing that the whole communion of saints is cheering you on from the sidelines. They're rooting for you and praying for you, for us as a family together at Holy Covenant. So may we be disciplined in doing that which is good. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So let us now stand as we are able. Claim our faith is contained in the Old and New Testaments. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth
Let us pray for the world and its people. Almighty God, we pray for Holy Covenant and your holy universal church, that we might be one. We pray especially today for those who are in trouble or distress, especially Reva Rashke and Don Embry, among others in our congregation that need your special love and compassion. We pray for our community of Katy and for Houston. We pray for those who face violence, those who face discrimination. We pray that there might be peace as we work for a more just community. We pray for the world and its leaders, and all those who serve the common good, that we might have a better community. We pray this to you, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. God's people, reconciled to God and to one another, I invite you to stand and pass the peace of Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you. Peace.
And if you're visiting with us, whether it's your first time or your 100th time, I hope you know that you are invited to come back and worship with us again and again and again. We just love having you here, spending this time, this hour and 10 minutes, in worship with us here at Holy Covenant. But I would like to invite you to more. To more than just worship. Worship is a fantastic way that we end our week and a great way for us to begin our week. But worship is not the end and the beginning or even the middle of what it means to be a Christian. Worship is just a step in our discipline, as Paul was preaching about today. Worship is just a part of us living a life of the disciple, a person who believes in Jesus Christ. And whether you are a person that is just now kind of wondering about faith and what it means and who this Jesus character is, or maybe you've been practicing being a follower of Jesus Christ for many, many years, or you could be in between somewhere. Wherever you are in your journey, we would love for you to join with us. Let us help you as you become a stronger disciple for Jesus Christ. You can help us become stronger disciples for Jesus Christ. We do this through Sunday schools, at times of getting together, building relationships, holding each other accountable. We do this through Bible studies. We do this through prayer times and fellowship times. This next Wednesday night, we're doing a Thanksgiving fellowship meal. Love to have you come be a part of that. For fellowship is just as an important part of our growth as Christians as anything else is. We would love to have you come grow with us so that you might also serve with us. For that is the natural ending of a Christian's work. That as we grow in our relationship with Jesus Christ more and more, we find those ways that we can look out and see the needs of others, and we can help meet their needs. Know that you're invited. If you'd like to find out more, we're going to be having a coffee with the pastors the first Sunday of December. And before then, if you'd like to know more, come talk to Paul or I. We'll be right out in the narthex, the lobby, this room, right outside the sanctuary. We'd love to have a conversation with you about Holy Covenant, about being United Methodist, about your place where you are in your Christian home. But come talk to us today, soon. Let's end our worship with song together. to the Pucharski family. As some of you have heard Paul and I talking over the last several months, we've tried to be very intentional with the fact that we want membership to mean something. We don't do just a general call at the end of our worship. Instead, what we invite everyone to do is if, as they are interested in uniting with our congregation, for them just to call us, let us meet with them, talk with them, either through the coffee with the pastors or one-on-one, to talk about what membership means here at Holy Covenant. And then we arrange times for those to come forward to unite with our congregation. Today, Nate and Stacy Kucharski have come to unite with our congregation, with all of you, be your newest brothers and sisters in Christ. We have Hunter here, and I'm going to make sure I say this right, Caden, right? Hunter and Caden, and I believe we're going to be doing baptisms with these two coming up pretty soon. So be looking for that. That would be fantastic. Hunter is already enjoying Wiggle Worship, which makes me very, very proud for him as he transitions into worship with all the rest of us here. And Mom and Daddy, thank you so much for joining with us. In the coming weeks, someone will be talking with you guys about helping you find Sunday schools, helping you find ministries to become a part of. In the coming days, we look forward to both of you being active in ministry here and service with us all. For now, I'm going to ask you all the question of joining all United Methodist churches. It is, will you support Holy Covenant with your prayers, with your presence, with your gifts, your service, and your witness? All right. Let me give you the right hand of Christian Fellowship, welcoming you both, well, all four of you, into our fold here. And I thank all of members of leadership and members of the church for coming and standing. They represent you all as they stand here with the Kucharski family. Following the service, I'm going to have them standing back here with me so they can see all of your glowing, wonderful faces. You can introduce yourself, and we can test them next week to see what they remember. All right. Paul?
We rejoice.
Oh, I forgot that part. Y'all do that. How about all you join in, all right?
We rejoice for very much to you as members of Christ's Holy Church and bid you welcome to Holy Covenant United Methodist Church. With you, we are our house, the Holy of our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, and everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
I invite you now to grab a hand of someone by you as you feel comfortable. And hear these words of blessing. May you go forth knowing that God calls us to work together for good, that the whole communion of saints is rooting for us from the sidelines, and that Christ walks right beside us and grants us peace. Amen.
Two.